you should have 20% of your money in stocks. So I'm gonna put 20% of your money in stocks, but which ones, right? Something that's suitable for you. So they might go buy a super high load mutual fund and stuff that money in their pockets just because it's suitable, but it might not be the best option for you. Does that make sense? Does that answer your question? Kind of? Can I answer it for you?
Yeah.
Well, when you look at, like, you talk about 2008 mm-hmm. and what happened then, and it was the banks and the insurance companies that basically caused the recession.
Correct.
Okay. And the American people suffered.
Correct.
And people lost their homes. A lot of people lost their homes. And
who polices all that? Well, the SEC is supposed to. The Security Exchange Commission is supposed to. Actually, I would argue, the banks made a lot of, I think, bad decisions. But I would also say that your rating agencies in this country made a lot of bad decisions, like Moody's and Standard & Poor's, that were packaging up everything they were doing and stamping an A on it. So they were responsible for policing them as well, and they didn't do their job.
But nobody was ultimately held accountable, and the American taxpayer.
Correct, yeah. Yeah.
So, and the laws that they did pass back then were repealed by the current administration, so.
Oh, you're talking about like the Department of Labor fiduciary standards and that type of stuff, the fiduciary standards, yeah. We're on two different sides of the street, right? Banks and brokerages are sellers of a product. They're selling you, they're developing a product and then they're selling it to you. We are just looking at all of the available products and saying, these are the ones I want to buy or these are the ones I want to sell on your behalf. But no, the SEC, FINRA, which has a regulation agency on us, Standard & Poor's, Moody's. So you're right. I mean, it was a messed up situation. If you watch The Big Short, which is a great movie about 2008, that it'll kind of explain what happened there.
Maybe you can shed some light on this, but with the 2008 market crash, wasn't that because these bank and brokerage players were giving people loans and such without checking the credential and paying
them? That was part of it. What they did was they were giving people loans they shouldn't have, and that was because of a law passed by another previous administration. And what they were doing is, as we talked about, there's, just for simplicity purposes, there's A rated, B rated, C rated, D rated. This being the worst, this being the best. And by the best means, okay, an A rated guy is worth $10 million and he goes and buys a $250,000 house. You know you can afford it, you know his credit quality is good, he's got a high credit score, FICO score, he's an 800, right? FICO, and he is safe, right? Worst is somebody who has absolutely no business taking on any debt whatsoever, has a terrible credit score, and give them a loan. The interest rate's much higher than an A rated, right? So what they did in 2008, what the banks did in 2008, they came out with this really great idea called the mortgage-backed security, and what they did is they took all of these together, packaged them up into one product called a mortgage-backed security, right? And when they did this, because of diversity of what was in here, Standard & Poor's and Moody's gave it an A rating. So even though you had, excuse my French dean at the business school, dog shit here, they put an A on it. And what happened is these started to default because you had people with very, very little money that owned two homes and a condo in Florida. And once these people started to default, it was over. And then it kept going. What they did even further is they created, you probably heard of credit default swaps or CDSs. And what CDS was, all these MBSs, they packaged all these together, made a credit default swap, and then they started trading these. So there's leverage on leverage on leverage, and once it went, it was over. There's no stopping. And they didn't get the taxpayer involved. It was really over. That's what they did. They made a lot of money. you're right, everybody got screwed. But that's what happened in 2008. Go ahead.
Does the program you run look just in the United States, or does it look global?
Globally, any asset class. Any asset class. So right now I'm working on a project with a guy out of Ohio. Where we're setting this program to trade. Bitcoin, right? It's hot right now. Moves a ton, but so anything. Bitcoin, Ethereum, Litecoin, USD. Anything. Like you could put anything. You could put, which is interesting, is with they're just data points, right? You're looking at a time series and you're tracking data in between there. This, if I had the ability, I could, and if I had enough data streams, I could track the number of likes an ad gets on Facebook in a certain time period and tell you whether or not that you need to rerun that ad or flip it to a new one, right? As long as I have the data, as long as it's in here and I can chart it, I can do whatever I want with this algorithm, right? So if I mean, it could be with anything. You know, if I have data on how many Chevy Silverados were bought over every 5 minutes for the last 2 years and charted that, and it starts to decline off, and we start to see the algorithm saying, go, it could change the body style, right? The application for this, in my mind, is endless, but right now we're just doing it here because it's the easiest for us to do.
So what's your take on the notion that this generation is inheriting the economic situation that was created by the previous generation?
Agreed. No. You guys all understand it. Student debt, car loans. That's the thing we're starting to see now is defaults on car loans and used car loans. And people are taking out 5, 6, 7 year loans. They're all underwater. I mean, you're buying an appreciated asset, a depreciating asset, and taking it out 7 years. I mean, I think. I would agree. We have to be a little bit smarter. A lot of us have a lot of debt, and we're coming out with a lot of debt, and we need to learn to manage that. I think the most important thing you can learn if you're going to come out of this, if you're out of school or something with debt, is learn how to manage that, get that tackled, get that out of the way. Because it'll, as you take too much on, it'll crush you and it compounds, right? So I agree with you to a degree. And I think, too, are you guys millennials, or I'm a millennial, are you guys Gen Z or Gen something? They changed your names.
I think it's like the last year, like 1996. For
millennials, yeah.
So a lot of
you guys are millennials. I mean, we were all told the story, right? Our parents, my parents were like, look, go to school, you get a great education, you're going to, right, which is true. It's how you use that education, you take on debt, and I think a lot of millennials are kind of in this place where they're like, hey, I did everything you told me to do, but this is way harder than I thought it was going to be. And I was told that, all these different things, but it's putting education to use and trying to do something. Those are very long answers to your question. Sorry. I'm trying to take up an hour and 15 minutes. So you guys can't.
No, you got
it's so nice outside. You guys are just sitting here. Yeah.
So college students now are coming out of, an institution with tens of thousands of debt. And even though they are making payments, the amount of payment they're making doesn't even equate to the level of interest in the long term run. So they're basically paying more over time. What's your advice on how to tackle that?
So they call it the, I'll give you two. The textbook advice tells you that you always pick your highest interest rate loan first payoff, right? So if I have a credit card loan at 14%, you want to pay that thing to zero as fast as possible. And then pick your next one, then your next one, and tear it down, right? That's the textbook financial planning approach. The other way to do it, and it's gaining a little bit more popularity, and I'll send you, it's a free class that my friend Sean Jantz does. It's Sean Jantz Courses, and he does a debt freedom course. And what he does is say, look, pay minimum payments on all of your loans regardless of the interest rate, and then take all the extra money you have available by paying minimum on all these, and just pick the one with the shortest amount of time to pay off, and pay that one off. Then use that money to pay down the next one. Then use that money to pay down the next
completion.
One. It waterfalls.
Completion.
What's that?
It's about completion. Get rid of one quicker.
Complete one. Take that money. Complete one. Take that. Then you're combining and you're paying off the bigger ones faster. I'll send that to you. And you can Sean. Yeah, it's Sean Jantz. S E A N J A N T Z. He does. It's called the Freedom Debt Formula. Skip to the last course because he talks a lot about a bunch of stuff, and then he finally gets to the point at the end. And, he has an Excel spreadsheet on there. You can put your information, you can put your loans in there, and it'll show you exactly when they're all getting paid off, and you can kind of toggle it. Okay, I now have $100, and it'll show you what to do. It's a really good resource.
I that.
What else you guys have for me?
I don't think I have all my.
All good?
Yeah.
Anything else? Are we going to talk about accounting? Are we going to talk about life insurance? Are we going to talk about
retirement?
Well, why don't you mention a podcast?
Yeah, we actually haven't done it in a while, but if there's certain topics that you're interested in, we had a podcast. It's 30 some episodes called The Investment Advisors. It's on iTunes. We had a couple of guests on there. We talk about educational things. We talk about technical analysis, we talk about quantitative analysis, we talk with other mutual fund managers, we talk with hedge fund managers, we talk with people from everywhere, and just have discussions. So if you have a question about, the financial planning process, or, it's all kind of in there. We have 37 episodes of that. I've just been so busy. I can't do that. It's about time you get a guest, and then they're in for 2 hours, and then you got to edit it. We did a pretty good run. 37 episodes is pretty good. I'm trying to think of any. So I have on our website, we have a blog with certain topics. We talk about target date funds. We talk about emotional bias in investing. We have a bunch of resources there. I have a maybe is it 5 Minute Money? Or something. There's a podcast called 5 Minute Money, 5 Minute Millennial Money, or something like that. They have 200 episodes and they're 5 minutes long. If you have a question on car loans, you have a question on should I lease or buy, they have little 5-10 minute snippets in there where you guys can get a ton of free information on anything that you could possibly imagine. I would check that out as well if you have questions.
Anybody else? Thanks, Ben.
Thank you.